Got a bunch of old men.
I read something the other day, you probably already knew, but I think they said in 1922 they found King Tut's tomb.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
And what all, they said they found a jug of honey in an earth 30.
See if I have, there we go. Good to have you with us for our Bible class this evening. We'll be in Acts chapter 28, so we'll be finishing the book. And as I had promised, on Sunday we're going to start our study of the book of Revelation. I have done the introductory lecture, and I have it almost finished. But it may take 2 weeks to even, or two times to even do the introduction, because there's so much I want to do on the front end so that you have a feel for what we'll be looking at in the book. But we'll be looking at the book of Revelation, and we'll work through at least the first six chapters, and we may jump and then pick some other chapters along the way that are particularly interesting. But at least chapters 1 through 6. All right, chapter 28, we begin. When they had brought safely, when they had been brought safely through, then we found out that the island was called Malta. The natives showed us extraordinary kindness, for because of the rain they had set in, because of the cold, they kindled a fire and received us all. But when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, a viper came out, and because of the heat, it fastened itself to his hand. Interesting language. Not the kind of thing any of us like. Most of us are not big fans of snakes. And he has a snake here. It's not until they get to shore that they really, really even realize where they are. They get to the island and finally discover that the island that they've landed on is called Malta. The island is Malta. It's called Melita. That is the Greek name for it. And it comes really from a Canaanite word that means refuge. It was a place that folks would go for refuge to get away from other folks. And so it's very much a kind of an island that nobody really, not many people back then would have lived on, but there's a whole group of folks who do. It lies 58 miles south of the island of Sicily and 180 miles from Libya. Libya, by the way, is northern Africa, and we'll see that in just a moment. The island measured just 17 miles at its longest from the southeast to the northwest. And I'll show you just a moment what that looks like. It's a long, skinny island. It's 9 miles wide at its widest point from east to west. It became a part of the Roman Empire in 218 BC and was part of the Roman province of Sicily. And we'll talk more about that as well. So here's our nice map that shows where we've sailed to. And you'll notice that if you're looking at the map, we have now, you'll notice all these waving lines. That's where the boat is going wherever it wants to go because of the shipwreck. And they're going to shipwreck on Melita or Malta, Malta. Interestingly enough, it's that little tiny red dot. It's so small that it doesn't even show up on this map. And I'll give you another map in just a moment. This is what the island itself looks like. It's an aerial view that I was able to find. But you can see, again, 11 miles from the tip on the bottom right-hand side to the top side and just 7 miles across. So it's a little tiny island. Today it's a kind of resort island where folks will go who want to get away from the city. The natives had Phoenician ancestors, and they spoke a dialect of Phoenician. And so a lot of folks, I think, would have difficulty understanding them. The Greeks and Romans regarded them as barbarians, and in fact, the word natives in verse 2, the natives showed us extraordinary kindness, is literally barbarians. The barbarians showed us kindness. In fact, it's really an interesting word. The word is literally bar, bar, bar. And you see, that's what, when folks are speaking a foreign language that you don't know, it sounds like that kind of noise, bar, 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 bar. And so that's what they named them, the barbarians, because they're saying that it's an onomatopoetic word. It sounds like it is. The islanders received the 276 people who were on the boat with hospitality. It's cold and rainy that morning, so they build a fire for them. And Paul, being the practical man that he is, goes off to gather some wood, gather some sticks. And as he's doing it, he encounters a poisonous snake. He's bit by the snake, and the snake fastens onto his hand. He will shake the hand, shake it off his hand into the fire. The word there that is snake, interestingly enough, is literally the word viper. It is a viper. There are supposedly no poisonous snakes on Malta today. If they tell you there are none there today, and I assume they're telling us the truth, we're not sure what happened. It's entirely possible that the population there may gradually have ridded themselves of all the poisonous snakes. And I had a note there before. I've said about Ireland. You know, Ireland is an interesting place that was supposed to have had a lot of snakes as well. But there was a man named St. Patrick who apparently got rid of the snakes, but we don't know whether he really did or not, but at least they got rid of all the snakes, so they don't even have any on their island now either. And so it's really quite interesting. When the natives saw the creature hanging from his hand, they began saying to one another, "Undoubtedly this man is a murderer, though he has been saved from the sea. Justice has not allowed him to live." I'm going to talk about that word justice in just a moment. "However, he shook the creature off into the fire and suffered no harm." But they were expecting that he was about to swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But after they waited for a long time and had seen nothing happen to him, they changed their minds and began to say that he was a god. Interesting language. The Maltese drew the natural conclusion, it is the will of heaven that he die. And so it is indeed what the gods want. He's a murderer. He must be somebody really bad. And that's the reason all of this is happening. But nothing happened. Paul didn't swell up, didn't suffer any discomfort. He didn't die. And it's interesting that this story is told by Luke the doctor. He's telling you, well, that's what they expected, and that's what should have happened. That's the norm. It says, justice has not allowed him to live. Did you see that in the text? Justice has not allowed. And in reality, interestingly enough, the islanders are probably referring to a goddess named Dike. In fact, that's the word that is there in the Greek. It is Dike, justice. And so it is justice has allowed him to live. And so, again, they're seeing it's their goddess. Dike is the daughter of Zeus, and she was believed to watch over human affairs and to report wrongdoings back to Zeus. And if anybody was guilty of a crime, they'd have to pay for the crime. Maybe with their death. The islanders had seen this type of snake bite people before, and they knew what to expect. You know, this is what always happens. They swell up and they'll die. And Paul doesn't. Paul's unaffected by the bite, and so they assume he must be a god. Luke's abbreviated account here is interesting because you would assume that at this stage, good old Paul would say, "I'm not a god. Let me tell you about the one true God." I mean, that's what happened. You may remember in Lystra, when he goes to Lystra, they think he and Barnabas are gods because of the miracles they've done. And he will say, no, we're not gods, we're just men. And you kind of assume that to happen here. But Luke abbreviates the account at this stage, and he doesn't give us that detail. Now, in the neighborhood of the place where the islands, were lands, belonging to the leading man of the island named Publius, who welcomed us and entertained us courteously for 3 days. It happened that the father of Publius was lying in a bed, afflicted with recurrent fever and dysentery. And Paul went to see him, and after he had prayed, he laid his hands on him and healed him. After this had happened, the rest of the people of the island who had diseases were coming to him and getting cured. They also honored us with many marks of respect. When we were setting sail, they supplied us with all that we needed. Interesting language. The deeds of healing at Malta are in verses 7 through 10. The lands belong to this chief man, and the word is literally, he's the first man of the island. And interestingly enough, we have Maltese inscriptions, and the Maltese inscriptions will always call the leader of the land there the first man. That's the term they use. And again, as I was telling you earlier, it's amazing to me and amazing to everybody who reads this how Luke gets all the right terms to describe the leaders of the land. Wherever he is, he's going to use the right term. And so he clearly has been there and he knows what he's talking about. This chief man is, a current chief man is Publius. It is difficult to imagine his home having enough to accommodate 276 people. It'd have to be a huge place. It seems to be a rather nice place. Perhaps when he says he welcomed us, he means Luke, because it's us. You know, we're in a we section. He welcomed us, and that's undoubtedly Luke and Paul, maybe Aristarchus, who traveled with them. You may remember he's the fellow from Macedonia who's traveling with them. And also maybe Julius, who is the fellow who's the centurion who's in charge of him. And so the us may be just those folks, the inner circle. And he has apparently an exquisite estate. His father has a gastric fever and dysentery. Malta, interestingly enough, had a common illness that was due to bacteria in goat milk. And so they think that that may be what's being described here. Apparently that was very common during this period. Folks who would use goat milk for cooking or just drinking the goat milk would get this kind of a dysentery. And so he has this terrible dysentery. After the prayer, Paul places his hands on him and heals him. That's the way that Paul himself is healed. Remember, a good old Ananias will lay his hands on him and his blindness will go away. It will fall away like scales. And so all of that's interesting. The rest of the sick on the island come to be cured as well. He'll heal them. God uses Paul to bring healing to numerous people. And probably we're going to get a church established on Malta because of this. By the way, it's really interesting. I think we've sometimes misunderstood the nature of miracles. It wasn't just sort of a miracle. Anytime you wanted to do a miracle, you did a miracle. The miracles were always designed to bring faith. To bring folks to faith. It wasn't always that a person has faith and they're healed, but they're brought to faith because of the miracles. It's interesting that the periods of miracles, that if you're reading through your Bible, periods of miracles, interestingly enough, are during the time of Moses and during the time of the prophets and then during the time of Jesus. And then during the time of the early church. And all of those were times when there's a new declaration from God. When folks need to know that this message that's being given is from God. And so I don't think it's any wonder that we don't have those kind of miracles today. We have the revelation in our Bibles today, once and for all. And we have the once and for all death of Jesus. And so it's all taken care of. They honored us in many ways, probably financial support, maybe some gifts. Luke will elaborate a little bit more in the remainder of this verse in just a moment. It's time for them to leave. The grateful inhabitants saw to it that the Christians should not be in need during the rest of their journey. And so they're going to supply them with food for the rest of the trip, which I think is, again, noble of them. At the end of 3 months, we set sail on an Alexandrian ship, which had wintered at the island, which had the twin brothers as its figurehead. After we put in at Syracuse, we stayed there 3 days, and from there we sailed around and arrived at Rhegium. A day later, a south wind sprang up, and on the second day we came to Puteoli, and there we found some brethren, and we were invited to stay with them for 7 days. Thus we came to Rome. And the brethren, when they heard about us, came from there as far as the market of Appius and three inns to meet us. When Paul saw them, he thanked God and took courage. Interesting language. This is the last lap of the road to Rome. And so we're going to get all the way to Rome now. And it's going to be in verses 11 through 15. They're going to stay in Malta for 3 months. Why? Because they want to get through the winter. You'll remember Paul said, don't sail now because it's bad sailing time, and they didn't pay any attention to him. And so they're going to stay there the 3 months, and they're going to get on a ship that has been harbored there because they had the sense to stay there. They got that far and didn't try to sail any further because they knew the storms would come during the winter months. Pliny the Elder says you'll get westward winds on February the 8th, which I thought was interesting. He gives you a day. On February the 8th, you're going to get these westerly winds that are going to send you the direction you want to go. And so it says they spend 3 months, and my guess is the 3 months are going to be about that time. And so they'll get this nice wind. Another Alexandrian ship had wintered at Malta. The other one they were on that got shipwrecked was from Alexandria, trying to get the grain there during the winter months when they needed it. But this one had the sense, the fellow who was in charge of this ship had the sense to spend the time there. Twin brothers is the figurehead, and the figurehead is Castor and Pollux. They're the twin sons of Zeus. And they were the patrons of navigation. And so you put those on there, and it's supposed to give you a good trip. Interestingly enough, we know them better as Gemini. You know, if you're watching your horoscope, are any of you Geminis? Ah, she's a Gemini. Okay. So we have at least one Gemini in our group. I figured we have to have at least one. But supposedly, they're going to give you good fortune during storms. And so you can see why they'd want to put those gods, if you believe in those gods, out front in your ship. They sailed from Malta to Syracuse, which is on Sicily, and they'll stay there 3 days, and they wait for favorable winds. From Syracuse, they will tack to Rhegium at the toe of Italy. And so here it is. Now you can see on our map where we are now. Again, they have now sailed, there's Malta, up to Syracuse, up to Rhegium, and you see the toe, it looks like a boot almost, of Italy, right there. And interestingly enough, they're going to get there and spend 7 days there. Now, why is Paul always staying 7 days places? He wants to be there to be there for a worship period, right? And so he's going to meet Christians there. Now, how do you get Christians there? Well, you got to remember, on the day of Pentecost, there were folks from Rome, and some of them may also have had land down lower and may have gone down, or may have just gone down there to establish churches. And so all of that's interesting. Every place Paul goes, we find churches, and they will all greet him and be glad to see him. They wait for favorable winds. They take a southerly wind after one day to Puteoli on the Bay of Naples, and they travel 180 nautical miles in less than 2 days. And so the winds are favorable. That's a lot of traveling. It's 90 miles a day. There were Christians at Puteoli, important seaport, and an important Jewish community. With the aid of a southerly wind, the large grain vessel makes that 180-mile trip in just 2 days. Paul spends a week with the brethren. Perhaps the centurion had some official business he needed to take care of, which allowed them to have that special time. But it would allow them to stay long enough to worship with the Christians. And that becomes important for Paul. Again, Paul will worship undoubtedly with them. They will take there will be folks who will take the Appian Way to Rome, one of the great Romes in southern Italy. Before they arrive in Rome, the news had already arrived there, and the Christians set out from the Appian Way to meet them and escort them into the city. One group met them at the Three Taverns, 33 miles from Rome. And so there we go. And the three inns or the three taverns right there. And you can see how close it is to Rome. From there they go another 10 miles to the market town of Appia, or the Appian Forum, the Appian Way. Paul takes courage. 3 years earlier, Paul had written the Romans expressing his desire to be with these Christians. I think he really thought he would pay the fare and just sail there. That's not how he gets there. God in his providence will get him there, but it won't be the way he expected to get there. His prayer indeed is granted. When we entered Rome, Paul was allowed to stay by himself with a soldier who was guarding him. After 3 days, Paul called together those who were leading men among the Jews, and when they came together, he began saying to them, "Brethren, though I had done nothing against our people or the customs of our fathers, yet I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. And when they had examined me, they were willing to release me because there was no ground for putting me to death. But when the Jews objected, I was forced to appeal to Caesar. Not that I had any accusation against my nation. For this reason, therefore, I requested to see you, to speak to you, for I am wearing this chain for the sake of the hope of Israel." So, Paul's now, he's in Rome, and interestingly enough, he asks for the leaders in the synagogues in Rome to come and see him. He wants to see his fellow Jews. Now, notice that's Paul's regular pattern, right? You always go to the synagogue, but he can't go to the synagogue. He won't be able to go to the synagogue. And so he's going to call for those folks to come and see him. Luke doesn't desert Paul. He's going to be with Paul a bit longer. And in fact, in Philemon and Colossians, he's there at least that part of the time when Paul is writing those letters. And he'll be there. Just as he had done at Caesarea Maritima, though, he's going to go off, and I think he's going to disappear. We're going to move out of a we section to a section that's not we. And I have a feeling he's now off writing the book of Acts. As I told you earlier, while he was being imprisoned in Caesarea Maritima, he disappeared there, and I think he was writing his gospel then. Now, again, if you're reading all of these commentaries, especially a lot of the commentaries, you're going to discover that many of them are going to suggest that these books are written much later. But I think it's got to be written fairly early, because I think Paul is still in prison when this book is being written. Because if he'd gotten out of prison, I think Luke would have said, "Oh, he was released, see, just like God said." And that doesn't happen. We'll talk more about that in a minute. Yes.
In fact,
it's really interesting that for the longest time, all of the scholars, mainly pretty liberal scholars, who really doubted the authenticity of the Bible, are dating all of these things very late. But now, a lot more of the, especially the conservative ones, are standing up for it being written early. Yeah, that's exactly right. Paul has a degree of liberty. He lives in a rented house, and he lives as a private citizen. He has a soldier that is chained to him. In fact, he'll make a big deal about being in chains. But he's going to make a big deal about the fact that he's a free man. And he's going to be able to have folks come and see him. You may remember there'll be a man named Epaphroditus who will find him, and others will find him while he's there. Good Onesimus, he will bump into Onesimus, the runaway slave, while he's in Rome. All of those things mean that he has special freedom. As a Roman citizen, I think that's the reason he has that special freedom. A soldier is detailed to guard him, and so he's chained. The book of Philippians makes a big deal about his being chained. But he could receive guests. The first interview with the Roman Jews is in verses 17 through 22, which we just read. He's unable to go to the synagogue. There are several synagogues in Rome. So he calls for the leaders of those synagogues to come and see him. He can't go see them. He calls them to come and see him. Paul summarizes the events that brought him to Rome. "Here's the reason I'm here, guys. Your folks back in Jerusalem accused me, and I had to disappear because of that." He emphasizes his innocence. He offers no complaint against the Jewish nation or the leaders. "I'm not complaining against them." His appeal to Caesar was to establish his innocence, and that's a big deal. He pronounces his devotion to the hope of Israel, a language that he used earlier with Agrippa. And what was the hope of Israel? It's the resurrection. And he makes a big deal of this. His finding and proclaiming the hope of Israel was the reason he was a prisoner. He was not undermining the religion of Israel. Rather, he was preaching fulfillment of their hope. All of the Jews as a whole, except the Sadducees, all of the Jews as a whole believed there was going to be a resurrection. And so he's just proclaiming that resurrection has happened and been proved by Jesus. And so here are some interesting pictures. That's the Colosseum that you see there, and the Colosseum is in the back in the top picture. But that's the Colosseum where many of the Christians are going to die ultimately under Nero. Nero, by the way, is the emperor now. They said to him, "We neither have received letters from Judea concerning you, nor have any of the brethren come here and reported or spoken anything bad about you. But we desire to hear from you what your views are, for concerning this sect, it is known to us that it is spoken against everywhere." When they had set a day for Paul, they came to him at his lodging in large numbers. Notice at his lodging, at his apartment of sorts. And he was explaining to them by solemnly testifying about the kingdom of God and trying to persuade them concerning Jesus from both the law of Moses and from the prophets, from morning until evening. Some were persuaded by these things, but others did not believe. Interesting language. The Jewish leaders denied a knowledge of his case. "We don't know anything about it. Nobody's sent us a letter. Nobody's come here to accuse you." And by the way, I'm convinced that's the reason he's going to be let go. Because according to Roman law, you can only keep a man in prison for 2 years. And at the end of the 2 years, you either got to convict him or you got to let him go. And he's going to stay there 2 years, waiting to see, I guess, if any Jews are going to make the trip to Rome to accuse him. And that's a long trip, and so none of them are going to make the trip, which will be interesting. Any chance of success for the prosecution of Paul is slim, because no one has come. Nero, interestingly enough, married to Pompeia Sabina in AD 62, and Josephus calls her a God-fearer. Now, a God-fearer. If Josephus calls her that, what does he mean? She's come to believe in the one true God? Yeah, like Cornelius. Cornelius is a God-fearer. He is not yet a proselyte, but he's a God-fearer. And she's not a proselyte, but she's a God-fearer. She believes in God. And so Nero should have had some positive effect. I mean, his wife should have had some kind of positive effect on him. She doesn't seem to. The leaders would like to hear more about this sect of universal irrepute. All of the Jews say bad things about these Christians. And they're hearing the bad things that are being said about Christians. They want to know more about it. The expulsion of the Jews from Rome under Claudius over one Crestus may be part of that. We talked about that earlier. You remember Aquila and Priscilla were originally from Rome, and they'll end up at Corinth. And they get kicked out of Rome because there is a division over one Crestus, which we think is probably just a Roman misunderstanding of the word Christos, which is the word for Christ. And so the Jews are fighting over whether or not there is a Messiah and whether or not the Messiah has come. And because there's this dispute, Claudius wants to get some peace. All he wants is the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome. And so he will kick them all out. Priscilla and Aquila will go to Corinth. That's where they'll meet Paul. They will travel with Paul to Ephesus. And then by the time we get to the later letters of Paul, they'll be back in Rome again. And so they'll get to go back to Rome. The second interview with the Roman Jews is in verses 28 through chapter 28, verses 23 through 28. The day is set for a thoroughgoing discussion. And when they did not agree with one another, they began leaving after Paul had spoken one parting word. "The Holy Spirit rightly spoke through Isaiah the prophet to your fathers, saying, 'Go to this people and say, you will keep on hearing, but you will not understand. And you will keep on seeing, but you will not perceive. For the heart of this people has become dull, and their ears, they scarcely hear, and they've closed their eyes. Otherwise, they would see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart and return, and I would heal them. Therefore, let it be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will also listen.'" And so he says Gentiles are going to listen. Now, that's what's going to get him in trouble, right? That's what's going to cause many of the Jews there not to believe in him. It's because of this language, of this message going to the Gentiles. and that's going to be troublesome. The argument here is like one we read elsewhere in the book of Acts. We have a kind of general outline. Paul gives his evidence for the kingdom. He seeks to persuade them about Jesus. He uses the law and the prophets, and he speaks from morning till evening. That's not unusual. You'll remember he has that midnight sermon, which Eutychus falls out the window. And so that's not unusual. Some are convinced, but the bulk of folks are unpersuaded. The primary reason is they're unprepared for this message to go to Gentiles. It's okay to preach the message. And they wouldn't have had a lot of difficulty if he'd insisted that everybody become a Jew first, become a proselyte, and then become a Christian. But again, that was one of the things in Acts 15 that the group decided doesn't have to happen. Paul uses Isaiah chapter 6, verses 9 through 10 that we just saw. And here it is from Isaiah. He said, "Go tell the people, keep on listening but do not perceive, keep on looking but do not understand. Render the hearts of this people insensitive, their ears dull, their eyes dim. Otherwise they would see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and return and be healed." The original message in Isaiah was a message that went out to the people in Isaiah's day. And God tells Isaiah, "I hate to tell you this, Isaiah, but you're not going to get many converts. The majority of the folks that you're going to be preaching to are not going to respond." And so now Jesus will quote this passage, and Paul quotes this passage, and Peter quotes this passage. They all quote this passage and say, it's happening again. They've got hard hearts and they don't hear and they don't see, even though they've seen. Jesus quotes that passage in all four Gospels and he says that's why the Jewish leaders reject him. And so that's the case. It was widely used by Christians to justify the Gentile mission. The reason we've gone to Gentiles is that passage in Isaiah says it's going to happen. Paul uses it in Pisidian Antioch, in Corinth, and now here in Rome as he's preaching to those folks. "Now when he had spoken these words, the Jews departed, having a great dispute among themselves." By the way, do you notice that's in brackets? The oldest copies that we have of the book of Acts don't have verse 29. And so if you're reading from your Bible may or may not have verse 29. Anybody have an ESV? Is it what translation do you have? You have New King James. New King James.
It is going to have.
New King James is going to have it. Pardon?
ESV doesn't.
That's what I thought. My guess was that the ESV would leave that out because it's really debated. It won't be in the new RSV either, and so they're going to leave it out. Now, I think it's put there because that's exactly what happened. But whether or not it was in the original is another matter. And he stayed two. Yes, go ahead.
NIV doesn't have either.
And the NIV doesn't have either. That's what I thought. I figured as much. Any of the more recent translations won't. I need to look. I have the new American Standard that came out this year, and I need to look and see if it still has it, whether they put it there, or whether they put it just in a footnote down below. And he stayed two full years in his own rented quarters and was welcoming all those who came to him. So now we know that his stay in Rome is two full years at least. He stayed two full years in his own rented quarters and was welcoming all who came to him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching concerning the Lord Jesus with all openness, unhindered. I'm going to come back to that last word. That's a big word that's really important in our text. The narrative reaches its climax now. The gospel is advanced unhindered in Rome, and that is going to be a big deal. Paul spends 2 years in Rome. He spent 2 years in Caesarea Maritima, Caesarea on the sea. He spends 2 years in Rome, so 4 years altogether imprisoned. He's under custody, not permitted to leave, but others can come to him. 2 years was the statutory period for prosecution. We assume that Paul is released after 2 years. He proclaims the gospel freely, and that's going to be a big deal. Arriving in Rome early A.D. 60, he's going to be released from custody perhaps as early as March, because you know I told you they couldn't sail till February, so it may be as early as March that he gets there. And so he's going to be in custody for 2 years, and that would mean he's released in A.D. 62. Now, what's the big deal about A.D. 62 being important? What happens in A.D. 64? Anybody know? Fire in Rome. And after the fire in Rome, who gets persecuted? Christians. Because there's a fire in Rome, and it's unfortunate, but it's fortunate for Nero, because the area that burns down is the area where he wanted to expand his palace. And so they all said, he burned it down. And so he says, no, I didn't. It was those Christians who did that. And so the Christians took the blame, even though they didn't have anything to do with it, which is interesting. Probably during this time, Paul does write his second volume. And if I had to guess that's the case, you may have noticed that we stopped. Our section isn't a we section. This last part of it is not we. At the conclusion of his writing, Paul has still not faced his trial. He's still awaiting the trial. And some think that maybe even this book is written as part of his brief that he could present to Nero to show that he's innocent to Caesar or to Caesar's officials. Had Paul already been released, it would be difficult to explain why Luke would not have included the outcome of the trial. Some think Luke was planning to do a third volume. I think I've told you that earlier. A lot of folks think you get volume 1, the life of Christ, volume 2, Paul is in prison, volume 3, what happens afterwards. And that might be the case, but we don't have that. Maybe the work was never completed, or maybe he never planned to write the work. I wish somebody would find it, though. I keep telling my students, I want you to go out and find that work, and I promise you, I will translate it. I'd be happy to be the one to translate it, but it'd be great to have it. Paul has been in custody now for 4 years. It would have made a better ending to the gospel and Acts to portray him as free from his chains and proclaiming the gospel to Gentiles in regions even beyond Rome. You'll remember he wanted to go to Spain. And it would be nice if we knew whether or not he made it to Spain. One of the activities that Paul engaged in during this time is letter writing. While he's there during that 2 year period, he's going to write the books that we call the prison epistles. They are Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. And again, as I told you, prison epistles is about a bit misleading because he's not in prison. Remember, he was in a rented house. And so he is being held as a prisoner, but he's really not in prison. When he writes 2 Timothy, he is in prison. And so that will be important. Yes?
Can you talk a little bit about Mamertine prison? Yeah,
I'll do that at the end, I promise. We'll get there. The Mamertine prison, by the way, is one that we know about and folks have gone there. And in fact, if you ever get a chance to go to Rome, I've not done that. I have been to Rome twice in the airport. I've never seen anything except the airport in Rome. I would like to go to Rome and see some other things, but all I've done is fly in there. So he engages in letter writing during this time. From his Roman apartment, chained to a soldier, he writes Philippians, Colossians, Philemon, and Ephesians. By the way, I put Colossians and Philemon together because I think they may be written to the same church and folks in the same church. The authorities must have known what Paul was doing, and they didn't stop him. They let him write those letters, and they let those letters go out. Somebody will take those letters for him. It wasn't illegal to do that. God was at work. And there's a triumphant note. The last word in the book of Acts is unhindered. Here's the text. Teaching concerning the Lord Jesus with openness, unhindered. And the book ends with that word, unhindered. Isn't that interesting? That's an interesting way to end a book. And so God is doing it and wonderful things are happening. And Paul will make a big deal of the fact that he's able to preach to some folks he wouldn't get to preach to. Because there are folks who wouldn't go to church, but there are folks who were chained to him that he gets to preach to. And he'll make a big deal of that in those books we call the prison epistles. The victory of the Lord, the culmination of the gospel, first in Jerusalem and finally in Rome. You may remember that Jesus says, I want you to be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. And to some degree for Luke, Jesus' statement is fulfilled when we get to Rome. That's deemed to be the uttermost parts of the earth. The book began with that Great Commission, as I said earlier, and we've arrived there. It's interesting because Timothy and Titus, we learn that Paul is released after those 2 years, and he may have traveled to Spain. We just don't know. Folks in Spain contend that he did. In fact, they'll even name some churches after him because they're convinced that he made the trip there, but there's no real evidence of it. And in fact, we do know some things for sure. We know that he does travel to Crete, and from Crete, he'll leave Titus, and he'll write the book of Titus later to our man Titus in Crete. And then he will leave Timothy in Ephesus, and then sometime later he's arrested. And then he'll write 2 Timothy while he's in prison and expecting to die. In the book of Philippians, he says, I expect to be released, guys. I'm going to be released. And he's convinced of that in Philippians. But in 2 Timothy, that's not the case. Here are my two maps. I just put two of them up here. Now, this one is interesting because this one gives you a couple of possibilities. You'll notice in the red, if I can push the button here, he's in Rome. And the red one has him traveling to Spain, and then from Spain, he travels and drops him off in Crete, and then goes to Ephesus, and then he'll go back up to Macedonia, and from Macedonia, he will go across the way to northern Macedonia, across the area, and he will then travel, be arrested and taken up to Rome. The other one has him doing what we think happened, and that is he just sails from Rome to Crete, and then to Ephesus, and then up probably to Troas and across. We know he goes to Macedonia positively because he makes a big deal of that. And undoubtedly, he would have gone to Philippi if he went to Macedonia, would have gone to Thessalonica, probably Berea, then undoubtedly down to Corinth. And he may have he's going to spend the winter in Nicopolis. We know that. He will be asking Titus to join him in Nicopolis. And so we know that he does spend some time there. So that's one possibility. This one gets rid of all those red lines. And so you'll see the one that we think is probably more likely. And so this is the one, again, he will make the trip. Okay, where are we? I got to start in Rome. He goes from, here we go, Rome. Okay, he goes from Rome down to Crete, over to Ephesus, perhaps to go visit. He might have gone while he was in Ephesus to visit those churches that he established in this area, and then gone from there up to Macedonia, and from Macedonia down to Nicopolis, and from there perhaps over in Troas, and some folks think he's arrested in Troas and taken back to prison. So you've got at least two different versions of what's going to happen. We do know positively, though, that he does go to Crete, and he does go to Ephesus.
What did they think Troas? Of course, that's where he left the cloak and the parchment.
Right, yeah. He left the cloak and
we know he goes to Troas because he leaves his cloak and some parchment there. Really, two things he leaves there. He leaves some parchments and some scrolls that are probably papyrus, cheaper paper. And so it's cheaper paper and books, and he's going to ask for those. He's in Rome in prison, and he asks good old Timothy to pick those up in Troas and bring them to him because it's going to be cold in prison, and he needs that coat, which is going to keep him warm in prison. Comments or questions? We've made it all the way through the book. Amazing. And I'm done exactly when I'm supposed to be done, which I was concerned about whether I could get through tonight or not. I think this is an interesting part of the story, at least. And again, I think I wanted to do that part at the end just so you'd see what happens afterwards. In fact, I really had thought about, after doing this, jumping next and doing Timothy and Titus instead of jumping to do Revelation. But you folks insisted on Revelation, so we're doing Revelation. And we'll do that and go from there. Other comments or questions? Anybody? Yes?
Just a question real quick. We know in Isaiah multiple times the Jews were told to be a light to the Gentiles.
Right.
Okay. Was that because they saw being the chosen people as a privilege rather than for service?
I think so. They didn't
see it as a responsibility. And it really is quite interesting because to some degree, I think that's what's happened with many of our churches, because we don't see ourselves as reaching out with the good news to those around us. We sort of are ministering to ourselves. We're serving our needs. We're edifying ourselves, meeting needs that are within the church. But we don't reach out so well to others to share the good news with others. And so that's a big deal. But they were supposed to have done that. That shouldn't have surprised them when Paul is ultimately going out to those Gentiles, because God told them, you're supposed to be a light to the Gentiles. And they don't take it very seriously. Yeah, good point. Other comments or questions? All right, let me recommend, if you have a study Bible, it will have a little blurb at the front of your study Bible that will about each book. And I would recommend that you read that little blurb at the front of the book, at the front of the book of Revelation, before Sunday, and we will start our way, working our way through. I'm going to talk about the nature of the book and who wrote the book and when it was written and the kind of things you need to expect to find there, and the use of numbers in the book and all kinds of things like that, I think, that are important for you to know as you read through the book of Revelation. So that's my goal for Sunday. So I hope to see you all Sunday, and we'll pick up there. Let's bow for a prayer as we close. Dear Lord, again, we thank you for your word. We're grateful indeed that you have provided it for us. We're grateful to be able to study it and to spend time together with brothers and sisters in doing that. We thank you for the wonderful story of our man Paul, and for all that he did and all that he went through to share the good news with Gentiles. And we're grateful that that message went out to Gentiles, because that's us. We thank you that ultimately the message would come to us as well. We pray you'd be with us this week. Help us to be good examples for you and to live our lives to your glory. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.